Hello everyone. I hope you're doing really well in your part of the world and you are enjoying your baking. I really do hope that. Today I'm going to be sharing my top 5 tips for making 100% whole grain sourdough bread based on the lessons I've learned over the last few years. This video is an audio talk with some slides, so if you prefer to just listen as if it were a podcast, that would be perfectly fine. I'll also be adding a written summary of the information on my website, and you'll be able to find a link to that in the description box below the video. So without further ado, here we go. My number one tip for whole grain sourdough baking is to watch for overfermentation. This is probably the most common issue that I and other people have faced from what I have seen and talked with people about. Yeast breads don't suffer this issue at all. It's only sourdough breads that have lactic and acetic acids in them as a product of the sourdough fermentation that do eventually start to weaken the gluten bonds in wheat-based breads. This issue applies to all sourdough breads, but it is exacerbated in whole grain sourdoughs because they ferment faster than refined flour sourdoughs. There are no hard and fast rules, but you do really need to try and watch your dough and not the clock. That's a really big tip, which is a really hard one, especially for beginners, because it'd be lovely to just be able to follow a recipe and have it work. But unfortunately, there are so many variables at play here, especially with whole grain flours. It's even more variability there because they're made from the whole grain. They're not refined and made to, you know, exacting specifications like refined flours can be. So things can move, you know, quite differently for each person with different flours that they're using. The main variables are, well, the number one is temperature. So temperature of the water that you're using, the flour, and the environment. So consider if you're freshly milling your flours and you're using them straight away, they're going to be quite warm. So you might want to use cold water to slow down the fermentation of your dough. If you use warm water and warm flour, you're going to have a fairly warm dough and that's going to ferment really fast. How much starter is used and how old or how fresh it is, that also impacts the speed of fermentation. Freshly milled flours, as I said, they go really fast because they're super fresh and lots of lovely fresh nutrition for the fermentation process, and added ingredients, things like sugars and malts and milks and syrups, honey, things like that, all of those things can accelerate the fermentation process of whole grain sourdough bread as they can with any fermentation process. So what to do? Well, one thing I try and do is try and aim for a fermentation that is adequate. You know, you want to see some bubbles and some air in your dough, but try not to let it go to the point where it's doubled in size or over doubled in size and it's really, really extra puffy. And if you're seeing bubbles on the top of your dough, then, you know, you're looking at a very, very well fermented dough that you would want to do a fairly short final proof for that dough after you shape it and bake it. If you want to do a final proof in the fridge, which a lot of people do, then I would suggest keeping your first fermentation, the bulk ferment, a bit shorter. So you want to consider the overall fermentation of your bread in the conditions and temperatures that you have and the flours that you're using. If you do a very, very long first ferment and then a very, very long second ferment or second proof in the fridge, you're likely to have a dough that collapses or doesn't have a really good oven spring by the time you get to bake it. Watch the final proof. Keep it shorter than you think if you're not sure. If your dough has really puffed up to doubled, it could be that it's gone too far. And if that happens, don't worry. Just bake it straight away. I've written there, consider not scoring. I think that's good advice, especially if you're not sure. If you think your dough is over fermented, then scoring it is not going to help it. Scoring it will just give it more reason to go sideways rather than up, especially for freeform loaves. It's not so much of an issue with loaves in a tin, but if you don't score your dough, it will hold itself together a little bit better and be more likely to spring up rather than spread out and be flat. Tip number 2, if you have gluten, develop it. So if you have strong wheat type flours with really high gluten strength, and you will know this because they might be labeled as whole wheat flour, bread flour, or you might know that this type of wheat flour that you've got is made for bread making, or is developed or bred for making bread. It might be called strong flour, it might be called hard white wheat or hard red wheat, you know, lots of different types of wheat. But if you know that it is got a lot of gluten strength ability in it, then develop it. Because the more you develop the gluten network in your bread, particularly if it's a strong flour and it can take it, then the more likely you are to get a nicely well-risen, airy loaf of bread. So you can develop the gluten by kneading, by hand, or with a mixer. You can do stretch and folds, coil folds, lamination. You know, there's a million different techniques that bakers use to develop the gluten structure and network in their dough, including the shaping techniques. You know, how you shape a dough after the fermentation, that can really can sometimes make or break a wheat-based dough as well. Also consider an autolyse, so soaking of the flour in the water for very strong flours. An autolyse works extremely well with my good old Aussie hard white wheat. That wheat is really made for bread making. It is super duper strong and it can really come together beautifully with an autolyse, but not have as nice a texture without it. So that's interesting to know. It's also important to protect the gluten network that you've built in your dough, and that goes for strong flours and weaker flours as well. There are things that you can do to make sure that you protect whatever gluten strength that you have in your dough. And things like, not over fermenting the dough is important one to begin with. And taking care not to break the gluten web when you're handling and shaping the dough. So it's all well and good to make this beautiful dough, but then when you shape it, if you're too rough with it and you stretch it and break it, you're going to not get the same result as if you take a bit more care with the dough when you're shaping it. And just a final really important note that I want to tell people about. Flour protein levels can't be equated with gluten strength. So a lot of people say, oh, I've got a high protein wheat. Why isn't it nice and stretchy like yours? High protein levels are an indication of strong gluten in bread flours, but they are not the be all and end all indicator of a nice strong flour for bread making. Not all wheat proteins contribute to a good gluten network. I'll put a link to a really good scientific article about this below, but it turns out there's only one group of proteins in wheat that actually contribute to the elasticity and strength of a dough. So you might have a high protein dough, but if it doesn't have the right levels of the particular proteins that contribute to that, then it may not be as strong a flour as you think it will be. So make sure you think beyond the protein level. The best advice for that is actually ask the supplier, and if they don't know, get them to ask the grower or the mill who provided the wheat grain or the flour that you're using. Ask them, is this a really good bread wheat? Is it a strong flour for bread making? They should be able to tell you whether or not it's got that ability to have a really good gluten structure. Now for tip number three. This is quite a different subject altogether. Tip number three is to use binders when you're using no or low gluten flours. So this is the whole other end of the spectrum. It's all well and good to learn how to make big puffy wheat-based breads with lots of gluten in them, but in gluten-free flours or very low gluten flours, using some binders sometimes can really help to give the dough some more structure, which allows it to rise and get a better volume. So my favorite binders that I use in my gluten-free sourdoughs, or my what I call hybrid loaves that have, you know, they might have a mixture of wheat flours but also gluten-free flours, all sorts of things go in there. I often use psyllium husk or ground linseeds or flax seeds or even ground or whole chia seeds. So when these ingredients come into contact with water, they gel up. And you can either pre-gel them before you mix them into your dough, or you can mix them into the flour just dry and then hydrate the dough as you normally do, and these ingredients will help add a little bit more structure to the dough. Some people use eggs and things like guar gum and xanthan gum, which are in a lot of commercial gluten-free bread mixes. I haven't used any of those last three, so I can't say much about them. I personally prefer the whole seed binders, just from a whole foods perspective. My favorite is actually ground flax seed, and chia seed is probably a second. Psyllium husk works the best as a binder, but I love the flavor and the whole food aspect of the other two, that they're made from the whole seed. So I'll put some links below to a video I made about that subject if you want to learn more about that, but that's something to consider too. And yeah, that can be a really good tip. Number four, hydrate your dough well, but be willing to make adjustments. So hydration is a tricky one. It's a little bit like fermentation. It can be a fine line between having a really nicely hydrated whole grain sourdough bread, but overhydration can be an issue, just as underhydration can be. But yeah, sometimes knowing where the line is with your flour is a bit tricky. So you do have to be willing to adjust and experiment and learn your flours and how they perform. Generally speaking, whole grain flours absorb more water than refined flour. And it's because the flours are made with all of the parts of the grain milled into the flour. I have found that freshly milled flours, I think they absorb more water than store-bought whole grain flours as well. I haven't tested that in any scientific way, but I just feel like they do. They seem to just have a bit more of a gelatinous quality, and when you add lots of water to a freshly milled whole grain flour dough, it seems to just suck it up really nicely and just has a beautiful texture. Anyway, I'm not sure. I'll need to experiment more with that. Strong whole wheat doughs, so whole wheat bread dough made with really strong whole wheat flour, so the high gluten flour, you can achieve a really nice light open crumb with really light handling and super duper high hydration, so 90 to 100%. You know, in some cases, you could even push it a bit higher. You're not going to get the same really open crumb if your hydration is a lot lower. I think those kinds of breads really benefit from a high hydration. On the other hand, low gluten or gluten-free loaves made with binders, they also benefit from high hydration, you know, up to and even in some cases well over 100% hydration. So, and this is because the binders, particularly psyllium husk, they're extremely absorbent. They absorb a lot of water, so you need lots and lots of water if you're using binders in your dough. As I said, learning to adjust the water levels for your flour is really important, as it is for any baking. But in the case of whole grain sourdough baking, those variations are far more pronounced. Our flours are coming usually from stone mills. They're not sifted and graded and scientifically adjusted to have a uniform quality like refined bread flours are. So they're much more subject to variations and little idiosyncrasies between each different flour. I mean, really, our flours are coming from individual crops, usually. Whole grain cereal crops can vary from season to season as well. So you'll always need to be making adjustments as you go along. So learning to read the dough rather than the recipe is a really good tip if you can, you know, stick with it and develop those abilities. And number five, last but not least, I think it's really important to adjust your expectations a little bit. I don't hear it too often, but I do hear from some people sometimes wondering why their whole grain sourdough breads just don't look the same as somebody else's who's used refined flours in their bread. It's just not possible to make breads that look like refined flour breads. Well, actually, it is. I've made some whole grain sourdough breads that look way better than refined flour breads in terms of nice big open crumb and that sort of thing. But generally speaking, if you've got the same amount of skill and the same knowledge and you apply that to a whole wheat sourdough bread, for example, compared to a refined bread flour bread, you're always going to get a lighter and more open crumb from a refined flour bread. But I presume that people come to this style of bread baking because they're interested in more than looks. They're interested in health and nutrition, and the beauty of whole grain sourdough is that it is the most superb fuel for your body, and I don't think you can improve on it really. I think the most important thing to do is to just embrace it for what it is and enjoy it, and a big part of the fun of it is the challenge of trying to get a better product. But in the end of the day, we still need to work with the flours that we have and accept that even if they don't look like some Instagram worthy beautiful tartine style loaf, then you know we're still going to have really good nutrition for our body. And at the end of the day, food is fuel, and we're fueling our bodies to fuel our lives and the things that we want to be able to do with our life. So we're looking after our health, and you know, embrace the challenge, but accept it for what it is too. And you know, try not to expect brilliant things all the time from your whole grain sourdoughs. You know, the occasional brick won't hurt. And in fact, you know, if you slice them thinly and toast them and put really nice toppings on, bricks can be just the best bread ever. Thanks for listening, everyone. I hope that was helpful and I didn't waffle on too much. I try to keep my videos short, but there's just so much to say on these subjects. If you have any questions, as always, please don't hesitate to ask them in the comments section. You're also very welcome to contact me via my website at www.ellieseveryday.com if you need some more info. Also, make sure you check out the description box below the video for the links I mentioned and more information, including where to get a mock mill around the world if you are interested in home milling, including some discounts available using my links. Thanks again for your wonderful support, everyone, and I look forward to seeing you again soon. Take care.